Good afternoon. I'm Tom McCullen, Executive Director of the Culver Herbert Library. It's great to have you with us here this afternoon for this this poetry celebration from Poem City. So, and it's great that here we have a nice, sunny spring afternoon, and we're all indoors to celebrate poetry. I love it. So, thank you so much for being here. Today we have two important poets with us. We have Ralph Culver, and Ralph's poetry, fiction, and criticism have appeared in many magazines and journals. His awards include a creation grant in poetry from the Vermont Arts Council, a nomination for a Pushcart Prize. In 2013, he won the inaugural Poetry Broadside Prize from Chickadee Chaps and Broads. And he also won the Anabiosis, I think is the right name, Anabiosis Press Chapbook Prize for his highly praised collection, Both Distances, which is on the back table, in which afterwards he'll be signing and selling. Ralph has also given many poetry readings and presentations throughout the Northeast. He's produced readings for other writers. He's a former lecturer for the Vermont Humanities Council, and he's past literary event coordinator for UVM's Continuing Education Department. Sid Lee was Poet Laureate of Vermont from 2011 to 2015. In 2013, his collaborative book with Fleda Brown, Growing Old in Poetry, Two Poets, Two Lives, was published. Also that same year, his book of personal essays, A North Country Life, Tales of Woodsmen, Waters, and Wildlife, was published. His 12th volume of poetry, No Doubt the Nameless, just came out last month, I think, March. In his fourth collection of lyrical essays, What's the Story? Short Takes on a Life Grown Long, was recently published by Vermont Green Writers Press. So, Sid, those things sound great, like being Poet Laureate and everything, but at the Keller Cupboard Library, the most important thing about Sid Lee is every February he's pronouncer of words and judge for the Cabin Fever Spelling Bee. So... Would you please welcome Ralph Culver and Sidney Lee.
Can you hear me?
No.
Can you hear me now? I would like to do a whole reading like that sometime. How you doing? I'm going to read a poem by Dylan Thomas. I like to start with reading poetry by someone other than myself. It's a poem by Mark Strand called My Name. Once when the lawn was a golden green and the marbled moonlit trees rose like fresh memorials in the scented air, and the whole countryside pulsed with the chirr and murmur of insects, I lay in the grass, feeling the great distances open above me, and wondered what I would become and where I would find myself. And though I barely existed, I felt for an instant that the vast star-clustered sky was mine. And I heard my name as if for the first time, heard it the way one hears the wind or the rain, but faint and far off, as though it belonged not to me, but to the silence from which it had come and to which it would go. And it will be downhill from there, let me tell you. I'm going to start with a couple of poems that are about childhood or based in childhood. This is called Taking Bluegill at Lake Seneca. Lake Seneca is in Ohio. My parents and I and my sister used to vacation there in the summertime. We lived in Pittsburgh. Taking Bluegill at Lake Seneca. Under the weight of a few rocks and the unmerciful heat of midday, they lie. Eight bejeweled beauties aligned on the edge of the dock, the first five utterly still, the two next murmuring at the gills, and the last not quite reduced to commentary, but yet in the veil of acts and action. A tremor shudders his length to the tail, the caudal fin taut and quaking, and I suddenly feel a memory fall through me of what it meant to consider surrender, remembering swimming for shore on a dare, our rowboat out too far, and the sound of thunder nearing. A limitless pain and fear deep in my thighs and calves, so pathologically engraved there, I stared down at my bare legs in wonder and laugh. But I am young, and so these fish are young. This water with its battered skin is young. The trees surrounding young. Even my father and mother are young. Soon the eighth captive is left, no belief in escape, but speaks instead his conviction of infinite release. I will not be the one to flay them naked or scuttle the flawless heads in the minnow bucket for the coons. I will not touch them again except to eat them. So speech is mine. The first words are small and have a taste of hook, the sting of a pearl of wine. Fill up. Lulled, he sits, a nothing in the vast back seat, amid the drumming of the gasoline, the stunned smell of worn felt and Marlboros. Two heedless growths perch on their collared stems, murmur the day and will not turn. Between them, the air bends out above the hood, the way a snake sends itself across the surface of a lake. He studies his debased reflection in the chrome plate of an ashtray mounted, damaged, at the center of his parents' seat before him. Gulf. He slowly leans into that face. It swells, narrows, and runs down the cracked silver. One voice enlarges, saying, "Watch it, honey, or you're going to be replaced." A laugh, a cough. They are always almost there. Where are they taking him? How could I, waiting for whatever was to happen, how could I not see where they were taking him? Boy at the Plate. This poem's dedicated to my children and to my parents. And I'll dedicate it to Diane Swan, too, whose lovely poem about watching her daughter play softball I always think of when I read this. Boy at the Plate. Spread, the boy's legs are unsteady as tent poles in a squall. It is useless to tell him, I know what this is. Waiting on someone who seems as near as the end of his reach to give him his chance at shame. That he hardly believes it is himself. I heard that voice in my head so many times, it became a weapon, the only weapon I had. It is useless to tell him, the same voice splits from the throat of the field mouse, rearing up to teeth as long as its own forelegs. Useless and wrong. For now, the boy must believe he stands in the mouth of the first fear birthed in the world. Later, in time, perhaps while watching his own and shaken by the glory of it that it is, he will see for himself the common fear, the common love he fell out of, now into, and watch and love and be thankful. Totem. This poem's based on a true story. It has a little epigraph at the beginning. Totem. One fall day, Jay, a boy of 11, found the decomposing body of a dog. It appeared to have been dead for some time. The boy worked the dog's head off the carcass, shoved a tree branch in at the neck, and carried the head down through some woods into an adjacent public playground. Totem. This new spine, screwed tight in the underpulp of a skull, formerly dog, as an invention of meaning in your hands, it makes sense. The park trees beginning to smolder with autumn colors jangle and jag. The possible beauty of things pisses you off. Your mouth waters at the lift and bell of young girls on the seesaw, but there's this terror of whatever's pushing the black hair outward at your armpits and balls, and who understands it at all? Left no choice. You came down out of the oak and locust trees, head high, leering, spittlish and lousy, concessively marking your borders. Your little corner of hell in September, school just on and just out that day, down to the playground and the children who must recall it better than I. Everybody hear me okay? Am I reading too fast, too slow? Good, all right, good. This poem's for Thomas Lux. It's called The Tinies. The Tinies. Bless them, the Tinies. Sipping a drop of tea from an acorn cap, changing a flat on a Lego car the color of daffodils. How I love them, the Tinies. Always on the lookout for the blind foot, the mouse sozzled and reeling from the meat of a turned apple. This one digs down through her handbag, one pea skin. Do you have the keys, Harry? The Tinies, who will care for them? Who will help paint their living rooms with a blueberry? Who can possibly tie their shoes if they hurt their fingers? The Tinies skip stones in the birdbath, set sail across a swimming pool with a week's worth of provisions meticulously cataloged. Oh, you Tinies, who will protect you? Danger is a storm the size of a hat. Death waits in the black thread of shadow that trails from a needle of grass. And yet, they know it is a world of joy. These Tinies, large as it is, large as it is. I have been, for reasons that I can't really determine precisely, I've been reading a lot of excellent prose poems in the last year or two, and so I've been trying my hand at a few, and I'm going to read, so these are pretty recent. I'm going to read a few of these. And I want to start also, this is not really a prose poem, it is in lineation, but it is, it's to the memory of James Tate, another wonderful poet. It's been a bad few years for some of my favorite poets. This is called Another Thursday Off to a Fine Start, and those of you who know James Tate's work, I hope you will find it cleverly emulative rather than patronizingly imitative. Another Thursday off to a fine start. I was feeling glum, disgusted with myself, to be completely honest, sitting in Rachel Decker's car on our way home from the Wednesday night poker game. I'd been ahead most of the evening and then stupidly misplayed my last hand. When we all gathered up our jackets and scarves to go, I was about $15 in the hole. Rachel hadn't spoken much since we left Stan's apartment, and I'd said almost nothing. There was the merest suggestion of light over the hills to the east, a thin, pale outline marking the contours of the ridge. Rachel slowed the car as we approached the all-night supermarket on Doyle and said, "You mind? I just have to get a couple things." Suddenly, I had an urge to buy a box of saltines to munch on in the car the rest of the way. "Sure," I said, "sure, why not?" Inside, Rachel went off in one direction while I went in another, looking for the saltine aisle. I rounded a corner and stopped. Blocking my path was the largest cat I had ever seen outside of a zoo. It looked like an ottoman upholstered in spiky orange fur, if the ottoman had enormous, glittering Caribbean blue eyes. Those eyes were something. It was as if two round-cut sapphire pendants were jammed in the cat's skull. The cat didn't move. I didn't move. And we stared at each other for a moment when a high, raspy voice behind me said, "That's Steffi." I turned my head and saw one of the third shift stock boys smiling at me. He was tall, lanky, sallow, one eyebrow cocked speculatively, your standard issue third shift stock boy. He had a name tag that read, "Hi, I'm..." "She won't hurt you," the stock boy said. "Steffi?" I said. "Yeah, Steffi, she won't hurt you. She's just interested in reading your thoughts," the stock boy said. "Really?" I said. "Yes," he said. I glanced back at Steffi, whose eyes were still fixed on me. "She'll probably fill me in on them when I'm on my coffee break," the stock boy said. "That's nice," I said. I have always liked cats, but still. I went looking for Rachel, who was going through the checkout with a few purchases, dishwashing liquid, three boxes of wooden kitchen matches, a carton of soy milk, some other stuff. Back in the car, I told her about Steffi. "You never know with cats," Rachel said. It had continued to grow brighter. The hills were beginning to take form, a jade green blanket someone had casually tossed onto the horizon. My cell phone hummed in my pocket, and I looked at my watch. 5 a.m. I didn't recognize the calling number. "Hello?" I said. "Hi," a familiar voice said, although I couldn't place it. "What's up?" I said. "Steffi told me to tell you forgot the saltines," the caller said. I opened my mouth but kept silent. Rachel was shooting me a look. "Oh," the voice said. "Another thing, waiting on a jack to fill a straight when Danny was showing one, with that look like he probably had a pair. You really should have known better." "Yeah, well," I said, "I thought, where the hell were you when I needed you?" "Where is anybody?" the voice said. Rachel drove on, the sun rose. Eventually, I decided we might get home. I can't decide on a title for this poem. Lately, I've been calling it Lecture, but it was published under the title On the Ineluctable in Strand's Collected Poems. So I think that one's maybe even too smart-ass for me. So, but anyway, you can maybe tell me afterward what you think is the better title. Lecture or On the Ineluctable in Strand's Collected Poems. I paused on the lake shore and looked out across the ice, ice as even and polished as a marble countertop as far as the breakwater. Long pennants of blowing snow lifted and sped over the gleaming surface. "Winter, bidding farewell," said the jogger passing at my back. From an errant sky, tinged the color of moss, seagulls convened now, landing in silence on the ice as a group, standing, facing me as a group, as though each gull were about to unroll a yoga mat. But it's not Tuesday, it's Wednesday. The gulls wait. This would be the time to light a cigarette, I thought, if only I smoked. Instead, they have taken out their composition books. Clearing my throat, I begin. This poem's called Camping Alone. As you lean toward the fire, the flames reach out to you, and you think of your mother at the kitchen sink holding a rinsed dinner plate up to the light of late afternoon. How she sensed you there watching her from the hall doorway, wearing your mantle of dirt and sweat that you wrapped yourself in every summer day at the ball field. But now the fire is guttering down, and you begin to feel the thin layer of grief that settles on everything, almost a fragrance, reminding you that memory, always memory, and nothing else, is the only fuel available to you to stoke the embers back into a blaze. Tableau. A boy lies on his stomach on the floor, head propped up on his left hand, drawing in a sketchbook with his right. So far, only a line or two, just a suggestion of a shape. Over near the window, sitting at his desk, a man stares at a sheet of paper rolled into a typewriter. A few words are there, nothing substantial. And the third figure in the room, whose very form is nascent, untroubled by detail, nearly transparent, really. Although the man and the boy sense a presence, acknowledge it, they pay it no mind. Confident as they are, as you are reading this, as I am writing it, that now is not the time the figure congeals, casting a shadow at last, and rises to take his measure. This is the last prose poem I'll read. This is called The Problem of Poetry, which is here in Montpelier as part of Poem City at a bus stop. I don't know what bus stop, but as I hope you'll see, it's appropriate. The problem of poetry. The problem of poetry is not going away and will not go away. Standing there in the steady rain, waiting, it would seem, for a bus, and then there it is, the bus, the 87 Ardmore, as it happens, leaving a wake behind itself in the seething black water massed at the curb, slowing to a halt and the door smoothly opening, then closing with a hiss and a sigh, and the 87 pulling away to reveal the problem of poetry still standing there, drenched, smiling, perhaps a little too smugly. No gloves, no overcoat, no umbrella in sight. Here's the R-rated portion of the reading. We look like a pretty mature audience here today. Well, I don't know what Sydney has planned to read, but this poem is full of it's full of gratuitous sex and violence and sort of apocalyptic mayhem and destruction. So of course, as you have guessed, it's based on the Old Testament of the Bible. This is a different take on the story of Lot. Now, if you know the story of Lot, most people remember Lot's story from Genesis because his wife turned into a pillar of salt when she turned around and looked back at the cities of the plain, Sodom and Gomorrah, that were being laid waste by the Lord, which, as I read in an essay somewhere, what a human thing to do, you know? I mean, just that's such, why the good Lord would punish her for looking back is beyond me. But anyway, if you know the story at all well, it's completely insane. It makes absolutely no sense. I mean, it starts out with Abraham dickering with God about whether, you know, like, how many righteous souls will it take for you to save these cities? You know, like two guys in a Middle Eastern market, you know, like arguing about a bolt of cloth or something like that. And Abraham starts God at 50 souls, I think, and gets him down to like 10. You know, God says, 10 souls. Okay, 10 righteous souls. All right, we'll spare them. Anyway, it doesn't happen, of course, and God decides to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Lot takes off with his wife and two daughters, and God tells Lot to get to the mountains where he will be safe. And Lot replies, and there's an epigraph here. This is from Genesis 19, verses 18 to 20. And Lot said, Behold now, this city is near to flee unto, and it is a little one. Oh, let me escape thither. Is it not a little one? And my soul shall live. And God said, Okay. And the town is called Zoar, which is the name of the poem. A little town, and you know how it is. Everyone knows everyone and everybody's business. So when the stranger and his two preening tarts arrived, we gave them a good look. One old man in rags, eyes always on the verge of panic, a face the sun had churned to bearded pitch. Muttering, rapt, he wouldn't meet your gaze. And I thought, this one is going to be a problem. Still, it was the girls, no better dressed, but young, straight-backed, smug and teasing, who gave me the most pause. Sisters to each other, we assumed, but their companion, that cowed derelict, could hardly be the father of those two, with no one playing wife or mother in their company. And so we guessed they were two whores arrived from Sodom, enslaved to this decrepit pimp the heat and years had bent into a fool. Later, my brother's hips gripped tightly in my sweating hands. It came to me to cut the old man's throat and keep the girls myself. But blessed lust and drink made sleep of my ambitions. All praise. For by dusk, the shouting had brought us to the roofs to watch the soundless flame and smoke devouring the obliterated distance. No one saw them leave, the girls and the old man, but they were gone. No doubt fear or some surmise set them to flight. Had I followed them to carry out my plans, I might have died. It was 4 days before the scouts returned with word that nothing stood of the cities of the plain, only ashes, the charred bones of livestock, not a shrub or tree across fused and blackened sands as finely polished as a shield. No tracks leading to our gates, but what the scouts themselves had made. Zoar alone remains, the only sign of man beyond our walls, a crumbled stump of salt that some lost trader left behind, that beasts have gnawed away to nearly nothing. I'll finish up with some poem I wrote in the manner of Jack Gilbert. I'll dedicate this to Charm. If you know Jack Gilbert's work, I just suggest the same thing that I did about the poem that I read of that was sort of emulating Tate. Resolute, after Jack Gilbert. The towering sun, screaming whiteness high above the sea. The light-stropped waves along Long Island Sound, curved blades ranked and relentlessly advancing. That whiteness. The gesso Alex layered across another canvas, one she had stretched some nights before. How her eyes ground shut and teeth gritted when I moved inside her, as if she were dragging a great weight. Three of us, living in rooms barely adequate for one. Not that the baby and I will be there much longer. Thinking of my vast hunger, set loose by the smell of boiled eggs that slid across the Parkway East as I rode beside my father driving into Pittsburgh. Flame-tipped stacks of the J&L mills decanting smoke, sulfur pouring into the Ford through the open windows. Just 14, famished, wondering what would become of us, certain I heard the clink of empties jostling in a case of beer in the trunk behind the back seat, praying the university might let him keep his job, or not. If we open ourselves to quintessence rather than particulars, we gain in clarity, the way a bee does not recall a flower, but does its purposeful gavotte to point the way to an abundance. Spinning under the blows of the sun, helpless, the dazzling white sands ablaze beneath my feet. This helplessness that will set me to flight again, already beginning to resolve in me as anticipation, pleasurable expectancy, a kind of contentment. And I'll finish up with, this poem is called Fishing with My Father and the Craft of Poetry. And I'd like to thank Tom and the library and all of the folks behind Poem City in Montpelier for all the work that they do every year here. It's really a wonderful celebration. Fishing with my father and the craft of poetry. Hours holding the poles over the water. Hours of catching nothing or not much and throwing back what we did catch. What the hell was that about anyway? And yet today I have this patience for things that drive some people crazy. Standing in line at the supermarket, waiting for some fool blowhard to stop gabbing, searching for a coat button in the snow. The finely honed conviction that beneath this nothing is a deeper, richer nothing. Consecrating myself to the silence, and then to what interrupts the silence. Thanks.
Ralph is a really good poet. You might have noticed that. I noticed that when I actually judged that chapbook competition. There just wasn't any. There wasn't any competition. I was amused when he started out. How you doing? I'm married to an Italian American woman, wonderful, way out of my league, and I adore her family. But she had one relative, Uncle Tony, and he always. I asked her once, I said, there's something about Uncle Tony. Is he mobbed up? Mobbed up? He's a member of the Massachusetts legislature. I said, yeah, like, is he mobbed up? And I had this notion that I might take him to poetry readings. I'd say, read a poem and say, I like that poem. Uncle Tony here, he likes it a lot too. What do you guys think, you know? but I never did that, and he's gone to his reward. So I'll never try that trick. This is a great library. I mean, when Tom was talking about the spelling bee, if you haven't been to it, it really is just more fun than you can possibly imagine. It's hard to explain to people why it's fun, but it's just a lot of fun. And all the people involved in Poem City, as Ralph said, are to be much commended. I'll read this one. About 8 or 9 poems. I don't suppose you can stop me. This one is called A Man Tells a Story. It's based on a story that I did hear. My late friend Bill Matthews was once asked after reading it, I really enjoyed that. Are those real poems or did you make them up? A hard question even to understand, let alone answer. At any rate, a man tells a story. He described at the start how he bribed an older student to buy the wine. Rosé, of course. Some sappy song lay poised for the touch of the hi-fi needle. He lit 4 scented candles behind his curtains to cast what he thought would be a romantic glow. The flower, he snickered. The flowers, he snickered, were roses, needless to say. Oh, I was full of originality. He almost believed the September breeze was panting along with him as he crossed the quad to the bus. Soon enough, Sandy or Sally, the name doesn't matter, got out, they embraced, and headed back to the dorm. Meanwhile, disaster. The breeze had blown the curtains against those candles. Steam leaked out of his window. The firemen had already spooled their hoses and gone. Not much of a blaze, he intoned. but it was flame that doused our flame. He pretended to tear his hair, then needlessly called his wrought-up paradox so much poetic bullshit. And then he ended. These many Septembers later, I made for the porch, looked across the fields to the star-pocked river, and heaved a sigh as real as my laughter had been. Like everyone there, I knew from the start they were done for. But hadn't we all suffered broken hearts when young and, of course, recovered? So this melancholy I felt wasn't a matter of a couple's love gone wrong. It was how in time we mock our very own dreams, whatever they are. Our best laid plans, as the poet so famously called them, often go down in flames so often that we may think we've grown wise from watching them die, that now we're seasoned enough for irony. Such adult dispassion, however, is hard to distinguish from resignation. Our little blazes spread to places we never predicted, and when what's left of all we long for reduces itself to ash, we shake our heads. We shake our heads and laugh. I don't know how Ralph and I should mention that my successor, Chard de Niort, is in the back, the current poet laureate. Those kids probably don't call him poet low rate as my youngest one did. But so I won't speak for him or any other poet, but I know myself sometimes I have this feeling that to be a poet, I'm preying on other people's unhappiness, and it makes me feel mildly guilty. And this is a poem I think is premised on that. It's called How to Sort Them. That woman's husband works a graveyard shift in a warehouse someplace. He's a big man and sleeps all day. I bet he drinks. What do I know? Dark clouds are stealing in. Well, no, they aren't. That's poetry, and bad at that. She's a headstone color, gray hair, gray face. Her hooded sweatshirt's dull, like a sheet of old tin. It's as though she doesn't look forward to much but passing away. Her eyes are gray, too, though it's too easy to call them empty. Their tears might so easily flow. Oh, no. I'm fussing around for eloquence here and coming up short. The woman and I just nod at each other as we wait by the post office window. Though I'm a rather old man now, I go on looking toward some sort of future. I'm a big man too, which may be why that woman shrinks, or I think she does. We all like the postmistress, who's older self but spry, and despite her losses, still cheerful and bright. Her hairdo's new. I recall her husband, who was a person people here always called Big Mike. Some old folks claim the man could lift a barrel brimful of hard cider right over his head. I'd like to imagine some tribute to Mike. I'd write it if that were feasible. A character, Mike. He drove a truck that he'd brush painted pink. He lived with his wife and children and a bunch of critters and mixed breed hunting dogs far back in the woods. In time, the kids grew up and moved from here. But the family we remember seemed always so decent and gentle with one another. The postmistress wears that shirt she loves. It's a pretty shirt. Now, what shall I name it? Purple, fuchsia, puce? And how might I sort them, good and evil? How portray them? Let the clouds above, the goddamn clouds, steal in. No, let them hurtle. Kansas. This is based on Psalm 90, which in the King James Version has a line that's always appealed to me. We spend our years as a tale that is told. You will have remarked that I'm interested in stories. Anyway, Kansas. Joey and I sit in the Prairie Junction. He scans the menu, then orders the Prairie Burg. He's never been here before, but it looks worth trying. A man his friends call Marty just walked in. Marty pulls up a chair next to Lorne and Rod. They resemble a comradely flock of ancient birds. I decide I'm going to order the chicken sandwich. I haven't had it before, but it looks good too. I mostly want to know that there's God. The men have on the clothes they wore to church. Right after service, their wives must have gone back home. Bill jokes about the football team at KU. Lauren and Marty laugh as though they mean it. Shelley, the waitress, is a bit too loud, but nice. She's very young, but she's laughing right along. There aren't that many here, but they all seem nice. I call up a passage about the eye of God. I want it truly to be on the sparrow of the eye. I privately study the faces around the table. Anybody would tell you that Lauren is handsome. There's a certain rugged hawk-like look to Rod. Though he isn't handsome, he appears to tell a good tale. There's something in Marty's expression that strikes me as sad. He looks to me as though something bad has happened. Maybe it has, but I have no way to tell. His friends are being especially nice to Marty. They may know the man has something painful to stand. I don't know a soul at the Prairie Junction but one. We're not having much luck hunting out here, but no matter. It's good just to be with such a dear buddy as Joey. We swap our own little narratives back and forth. The men are of an age, and so are we. I don't want them merely cut down like that grass that withers. They've all been inside their church this morning. I bet that each has made it a habit to pray. These men I'm watching believe there's God, I believe. And as for me, I really want there to be. I have a connection to a part of Maine that goes back some generations. It's in a remote place, and by virtue of having been born quite a while ago, I was able to know a lot of men and women who lived in that part of the world. There are only 70 people in town, so I knew and know everybody. And they worked there prior to the use of power tools. They all worked in the woods, the men. And the women, whom it would be ludicrous to describe as housewives, worked like dogs to keep the home fires burning. Because they had no exterior means of entertainment, they were all fabulous raconteurs. And there was one in particular that I was very, very fond of, whose name was Earl Bonus, who moved to that town from the Brunswick side of the river when he was three and was therefore, for the rest of his life, referred to as an outsider. But he was, you know how it is in New England, a wonderful guy. And he was a river driver back in the era when people drove logs by water. And he couldn't swim a stroke, but he would ride the logs downstream, 39-day drive from Third Machias Lake down the Machias River to Whitneyville on the coast of Maine. And it was hard. He is just a wonderful narrator, had just a fabulous voice. I would have liked to rent that voice, but he had more pain, he and his wife, in his life than one can imagine. And unhappily, toward the end of his life, he took to, 94-year-old life, mind you, he took to drink pretty badly, and that was rough on him and those of his relatives, including his spouse, who survived. And this is called When the Light Fails. So little was left of my aged friend that autumn. His shadow showed all chiseled in the dooryard against the lake when the moon was more than half. In the chop, the water's surf broke like a mammoth tract of ice into sharp-edged slivers. The light's supposed to save us. I tipped the shade to see his backlit outline. His daughter had been dead for ages. Who'd think that a heart could fail in a girl of 16 and that so much pain would follow. His son, Big Mickey, came home from Vietnam. He said, "It's crazy. God knew how to make a man. Now this." No reason anymore to thank that God or hate him, he claimed. He'd sit all night out there in the wind, which usually calms come dark, but didn't that fall. The next son, Bo, was long dead too, for all his valor, fighting the muscular dystrophy, working each day till he fell, but rising, and then at last not rising. My window framed him, near motionless as the pines behind him, which paraded in their standstill file along the seawall he'd built, a pick and prize bar, his only tools but hands. Whenever he stirred, it was slow as he ever moved in his blinds for the ducks of October. It looked as if he parodied the gestures of some other person. He felt in the pocket of his woolen pants for his bottle and pulled it out, his arm inching up, his head back tilting. Then he did all that in reverse. I was so damn helpless. I wasn't magic. No one blamed his wife for raising hell when she came on those pints, always empty or almost empty, though he tried his best to stash them out of anyone's sight. This latest death, he swore, were the load that broke the critter's spirit. No matter, it didn't break hers. A woman who knew the identical grief. That booze is sure a beast, he admitted, but it seems the ladies do better when life bears down. I know it does bear down. No, I don't really know, thank God. And now that crazy little Mick had shot himself. My friend said his grandson's gun went off unexpected. A whole town did expect it, but my neighbor said no, bad accident. Meth, we knew, wasn't that. In the morning, he'd swear he'd shake like a wormy puppy. It ate up my heart, still does. He was always so full of life. He's gone, and I keep coming back to the light, prettily winking in water behind him, having paired him to silhouette. She recalls a book of sayings. For some reason, she's moved by his chilly withdrawal to search for a fitting proverb. Why this one? Stay from among wild fowl if you fear the wagging of feathers. He jostled the china from her old wedding shower as he made his bumptious way to the crepitant hearth. She whispers, fire won't be hidden in flax. Her bouquet, when she flung it, was caught by an old maid aunt who twitted after a wedding, beware a corpse. A joke, a taunt, but she still feels her own foreboding. Their wedding trip lulled her at first to imagine proverbial wedded bliss. She'd never known birds or sand so dazzling, nor yet known this restedness. As they strayed on that luminous beach arm in arm, the passersby must have witnessed what looked like young love. But come full dark, the palms in their sudden stillness, like milliner's plumes, unnerving sensations flooded into her heart. She could never quite find the right words to name them, nor quite complain that they hurt. At trip's end, it shocked her. The talk turned to anger, which at home soon became automatic. They were scarcely civil to one another, though they rarely grew histrionic. After this late quarrel, hunched, vulturine, he strains to exude self-control. Through a living room window, she sighs as she sees their small twin girls who roll and flail in new snow, making side-by-side angels. Then, watching a raven drop from a leafless blue beach at a murderous angle, she gives the window a rap. She longs somehow to set the world back to what had once seemed right. Now, pale dawn, for instance, pretends something black and the calmest of skies unquiet. Truth shows best naked, she thinks. A mirror grows dark on the chiffonier. In its glass, a vague image which rapidly alters, first feathered, then shrouded, then bare. This one is called Autumn. And just a passing landscape in the Olay. just a glimpse of a landscape. I live in the last town south of the kingdom, south of Caledonia County, and I was just driving up there for whatever, it doesn't matter. And I just saw a scene which produced this poem somehow called Autumn. Why not write something for those who scratched out improbable livings here? Someone has managed to sow this broken field with stones, it appears. So someone's scratching it still. Although that Japanese knotweed has edged the tilth. Two wasps in the chill attempt to catch sun on a rail of the bridge. The old local doctor has passed at almost a full decade past 90. He never seemed depressed. 70 now, if barely. It's an older poem. 70 now, if barely. I consider the field again. Someone will drag those rocks away, but they'll be back. The air smells like rain, which is fine. The summer's been much too dry. Nothing is left of the barn but some rusty steel straps and some nasty red osier. The stone fence still looks sound, but even there the knotweed steps over. Hadn't I pledged an elegy to the old ones who worked here? Who couldn't claim they thrived exactly, but maybe they likewise scented good wind full of rain, lifted eyes above this old orchard to the cloud-darkened hills and found their support somehow, somewhere, no matter. They kept going until they could go no more. The trees' puckered apples have gathered a flock of birds, and as they alight, they're full of unseasonable chatter, as if to say that all will be right. The old ones, I promised a poem, must have said it too. It'll be all right. I never knew them. They're gone. I say it out loud. It'll be all right. I'm actually lots of fun in real life. When I made this selection, I didn't realize quite how gloomy it was. That's the Gila monster on the, rendered by my very talented niece. I think that's a wonderful illustration. Sonia Jordan Lee, if you ever get a chance to buy any of her artwork, I suggest you get in on the ground floor. Quicksilver Spring. How can the red-winged blackbirds come back so quickly to croak from wetland cattails? And the dishes run so soon with snow from hillsides amid that odd leather odor beside the freshets. And all of these take me to late April morning, some 40 years gone, when I dropped the only child we had then back at school, who ran out and whistled and whirled on the merry-go-round in that muddy yard, working up his fragrant sweat, while rasping he-ravens overhead whirled and fought amongst themselves, for she-ravens perched in the leafing woods as skunks began to roam again, like the one I saw on this much later morning, poor sad creature clipped by a car, dazed mid-road with blood in its mouth, and something I swear that could have been tears in its eyes, which swept back and forth as though searching for what could have happened so quickly and how. And I'll close with this poem called My Wife's Back, which also has a small erotic R-rated component, which is one of the reasons she decided to stay home today. It's a long way from X-rated, but back longer ago than it's hard. And it's easy for me to imagine when I was about 60, 59 or 60, I used to jog. I would never say run. A real runner would laugh at what I did, but I used to run through the woods to try and stay in some kind of condition. And then my knees just wouldn't take it anymore. So in a fit of what that same daughter that called me the poet low rate referred to as geezer madness, I took up the sport of competitive flat water kayaking, which is great for me because I live virtually on the Connecticut River and there's no impact, and it's just something very zen, as there used to be for jogging for me. So I do that, but on those days when I'm acting in a somewhat more sane way, I will often go with my wife on the river in an open canoe and go much more casually and kind of drift down river and back up and see what we can see. So this is called My Wife's Back. All naked but for a strap, it traps my gaze as we paddle. The dear familiar nubs of spine bone punctuating that sun-warmed swath. The slender muscles that trouble the same sweet surface. We've watched and smiled as green herons flushed and hopped ahead at every turn and we've looked up at a red tail tracing open script on a sky so clear and deep we might believe it's autumn, no matter it's August still. Another fall will be on us before we know it. Of course, we adore that commotion of color, but it seems to come again as soon as it's gone away. They all do. My love for you over 40 years extends in all directions, but just now to your back as we drift and paddle down the tranquil Connecticut River. We've seen a mink scratch fleas on a mudflat. We've seen an osprey start to die, but seeing us think better of it. Two phoebes wagged on an ash limb. Your torso is long. I can't see your legs, but they're longer, I know. Phoebe, osprey, heron, hawk, marvels under Black Mountain. But I'm fixed on your back, indifferent to other wonders. Bright minnows that flared in the shallows, the gleam off that poor mink's coat, even the fleas in its fur, the various birds, the lust of creatures just to survive. But I watch your back. Never have I wished more not to die. Thank you.
Ralph and Sid will be in the back if you have any questions, and also we invited them to bring books in case you wanted to buy any books and have them signed. Thank you so much for participating in Poem City. There are also programs in the back if you don't already have them. Have a good afternoon.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.